We drove all the way to Arizona, drove a little ways into New Mexico. We've been all over the place. And I noticed around here in San Jose, there's a lot of nice trees here. Amen?
Yes.
And I noticed some of the people are friendly too. Yeah. Praise the Lord. I'd say hi to somebody and they'd say hi back.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
So that's good. It's good to be in church. Amen?
Yeah.
God is so good. My name is Anthony Henry. I'm from Cayenne, Alaska. That's near Kotzebue. Up in Alaska, Kotzebue is above Nome. My wife, Josie, she's from Point Hope. Point Hope is situated below Barrow. Let's say you got the top of Alaska here. Barrow's on the top. You go down the next village is Wainwright. Then the next village is Point Lay along the southwest coast. And then the next village is Point Hope. When we left Anchorage, it was 11 below. And then a few days later, it was 15 below. And then Fairbanks was 45 below, which is the second biggest city in Alaska, only about 60,000 people. to us in Alaska, that's sort of big. You understand that, right? Anyway, when we came here to California, there were 38 million people.
Yeah.
Man, that's a lot of people. Wow. God is so good, amen?
Amen?
God is so good. You know, we've been through trials, we've been through temptations, and God has taken care of us all the way, every single day. Right now I'm on my third igloo. The first two burnt down. That's a joke, amen? God is so good. I'm glad to be here with Brother Kim and you all. I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm glad I'm saved. Aren't you glad you're saved? My name's written in the book of life. It's good to have your name written in the book of life. I can't imagine a life without God, without the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Imagine if there was no God. We wouldn't be here. We actually wouldn't be here. Something this complex. There has to be a God. Amen. Thank God there's a God, a mighty God, a good God, a loving God. He changed my life. He saved me. Put my name in the book of life, changed my life, delivered me from alcohol and drugs and just from a wretched life, gave me a beautiful wife and 11 beautiful children, and I thank God for that. Amen? God is so good. there was a a Korean fellow who moved to, what was that place? Harlem. And he met this young lady from Harlem, and she was a colored lady, and this Korean fellow loved her, fell in love with her, and they got married, and they had a child, and their first child they named Martin Luther King. Amen? That's a joke. But God is so good. Amen? Amen. I heard that from one fellow, and I said, I like that. You know, I wouldn't doubt there isn't, there probably is Martin Luther King out there somewhere. Amen? Amen. All right, grab your Bibles. Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. God is so good. It's good to be saved. It's good to be a King James Bible believer.
Amen.
Did you know that there are people in Alaska, way up in Alaska, that tell us that you can't trust the Bible? You cannot trust the King James Bible.
Wow.
You have to get all these other versions. You got to do the best you can to find the Word of God. And they taught me that when I was a young Christian. I got saved during the time of, remember the Jimmy Swaggart days, amen? I got saved. A lot of young people got saved back then, if you remember. That's when the Southern Baptist Church was flourishing, too. There were a lot of people in going to church in the Southern Baptist churches. Now they're emptying out many of the big buildings. They have just very few people. I remember speaking to a Southern Baptist preacher in Alaska, and he expressed his hesitancy to preach on hell.
Oh.
And boy, things have changed. Many things have changed throughout the years. and so in Alaska, they tell people Even the villagers of Alaska, the Eskimos and the Indians, they tell them, you can't trust the King James Bible. You have to try to find the best version you can and do the best you can. You got to study as hard as you can to find the best version. But there is no book on this earth that you can trust. That's what they teach in Alaska. It's even affected the Eskimos. But you know what's so amazing? It's so amazing that God, I mean, the truth, his truth is, remember, sanctify them through thy truth. Yep. Thy word is truth. It's so amazing that God got a hold of some Eskimos in Alaska and showed them the King James Bible.
Amen.
Amen. And there's some, I believe there's some people in the jungles that know about the King James Bible. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I know there's a lot of them that know about the King James Bible in the Philippines.
Amen.
And in Korea.
Yep.
Amen.
Yep.
His word is going around the world, and I thank God for that. But ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, unto Jerusalem, unto Judea, and unto the uttermost part of the world. Amen. And Alaska is the uttermost part. The King James Bible, actually, Barrow is the northernmost community in America. And the King James Bible is up there. That's where I got trained, Pastor Nick Serino. From New York, he trained me for 2 years. Pastor Mike Grace trained me for 1 year. And I praise God for them. Great
Amen.
Bible teachers. Amen.
Amen.
Are you there? Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. And I will read verse 13 as well. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open under the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this time this morning. I thank you, Lord, for these people here. I pray that you bless them. I pray, dear God, that you take this message and use it for thy honor and thy glory. I pray, dear God, that you would build up the body of Christ. I pray that you'd bring conviction and encouragement and a challenge. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God is so good, amen. I want to focus on that verse 13. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. God sees everything.
Right.
Amen. God sees everyone. God knows what's going on. God knows even about the sparrow that falls to the ground. And we know we have a mighty God. We know we have a great God. Amen.
Yeah.
He's a good God. I thank God that he's a good God.
Yes.
Sometimes I often wonder what it would be like if God wasn't good.
Wow.
I'm glad that he's good. Amen.
Yeah.
And it's hard for us to imagine a God who could see everything, who knows everything. He knows even the very hairs on our head. And he knows every thought of every person on the face of this earth.
Wow.
He always has known it. And he always will know it. He's a great God. Amen.
Amen.
The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. There is none righteous, no, not one. We're all sinners. And no one can get to heaven by themselves. The Bible says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. People around the world are trying to get to heaven. People around the world are trying to make themselves righteous. They do all kinds of things. Many people torture themselves. Many people do all kinds of good works. And many people believe that if you love others, God will let you into heaven. And they come up with all kinds of ways. There's all kinds of religions. It's very confusing out there. Many people believe in reincarnation. Many people follow Buddha. Mohammed. Did you know that most of the, the Mohammedans call themselves Muslims, but they're actually Mohammedans. Mm. They follow a man.
Yeah, that's right.
And you ought to point that out to them.
Yeah.
They're Mohammedans more than they are Muslims. Amen. And that's, believe it or not, that's the fastest growing religion in the world. And that's why we ought to be out there street preaching, passing out tracts, telling people about the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't let one day go by without telling someone about Jesus Christ. Not one day.
Amen.
Amen. You can pass out one tract. And if your church has 10, 15, 20, 30 people, each member passes out one tract a day. And let's say 10 people pass out one tract. In 1 month, that's 300 tracks.
Wow.
I was thinking about the street preaching this morning, and I noticed there were probably about 20 cars for each intersection, and about 1 minute, 1.5 minute in between, they get a new crowd. And so you get about, in about an hour, there were probably, maybe about 40 intervals of, maybe more. And you're talking about probably a good 4,000, 8,000 people saw Bible verses this morning.
Wow.
If there's about 80 people in 1.5 minute, and you get 10 minutes, that's 800. Well, 12 minutes, 800 people seen the Bible verses, so on and so forth. That's good. They need to see it. Amen.
Yes.
Sometimes you can go out on your own if you ever get on
Amen.
Fire.
Amen.
Amen. Sometimes when the devil gets mad, you can go out on your own.
Yeah.
Amen. I do that sometimes. Sometimes, I get mad about some situation, and then I realize, wow, the devil, the devil's trying to distract me. And then I'd go pass out gospel tracts or something,
yeah.
Amen. And sometimes the devil uses that to try to distract us. And we're so focused on ourselves. We're so focused on our own little world. And we get distracted from witnessing. We get distracted from reading the Bible. And if you would learn how to stay focused, and it takes learning to do that, amen? Step by step, one day at a time. Don't let one day go by without telling someone about Jesus Christ. That's so very important, amen? Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open under the eyes of him with whom we have to do, amen? Let's go to Amos chapter 4, Amos chapter 4. I got to move real quick here. Amos chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. I have overthrown some of you as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, and ye were as a firebrand plucked out of the burning. Yet have ye not returned unto me, saith the Lord. Therefore thus will I do unto thee, O Israel, and because I will do this unto thee, prepare to meet thy God, O Israel. We all have to prepare to meet God.
Yeah.
Someday that day will come when you finally stand before God Almighty. Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, verse 4 and 5. That day will come. Time will go fast. My wife's father-in-law passed away recently. He was 82 years old. He lived a full life. 82 years old, gone by quick. I remember when I was preaching in Alaska about 6 years ago, I would say, hey, before you know it, you're going to be 52 years old. And then I'd preach that again. Before you know it, you're going to be 54. Before you know it, you're going to be 56. And you young people here, before you know it, you're going to be 58, believe it or not. I remember we met Brother Kim last year. It went by real quick.
Yeah.
The Bible says our lives are like grass that grows up and withers away real quick. Our life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Luke chapter 12, verse 4 and 5. And I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that have no more that they can do. But I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he hath killed hath power to cast into hell.
Amen.
Yea, I say unto you, fear him.
Amen.
God sees everything. God knows who you are. God knows what's going on. God knows that you need a Savior. That's why he sent Jesus Christ to die for us on the cross. He sent Jesus Christ. He shed his blood for us on Calvary. Amen. He sent Jesus Christ to save you and I.
Yes.
And the Bible says there's a hell, a real place called hell.
Yep.
And we know it's situated under the earth. We know what's there. And if your name's not written in the book of life, that's where you're going to go.
That's right.
You're going to go to hell.
That's right.
If you die without Jesus Christ. You need Jesus Christ. God knows who you are. When you stand before God Almighty, I pray and hope that you'll be ready. Amen. Revelation chapter 20, still in the introduction. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead which were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man, according to their work. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. There are many people in hell today. Someday hell will be transferred to the lake of fire. And in the lake of fire, they'll be drowning in fire forever and ever and ever. That's a scary place. That's a scary situation. I wouldn't want to go there. I've thought about that a lot in my own life, and then the more I think about it, the more I appreciate the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The more I think about it, the more I get a burden to reach out to the lost.
Amen.
I know there's a lot of preachers, especially in Alaska, they don't go out witnessing every day. They have their little ministry in the village or somewhere, and that's all they got. And they focus on one family or two families two, three times a year. And that's all they got. They focus on a youth group throughout their ministry, and that's all they got. But as far as public witnessing, they don't do it. And it's a sad thing. It's a sad situation. Those things are good. We ought to have those things. Amen. But we ought to be a public witness. Why? Because people are going to hell. People are dying and going to hell every day. And they're going in by the millions. And you and I can do something about it. Amen. We can take care of Alaska. You guys take care of California. How about that? Amen? Isn't that a good idea? That's a good idea. Amen? All you got to do, you know what? If you would learn how to fall in love with the Lord, fall in love with His Word, you'll get that burden. You'll get such a burden that He has that you're going to want to reach out to others. You know what? He got that burden. He got that burden so bad that He went and died for us on the cross. He shed His blood for you and I on Calvary. He paid for our sins on the cross. Amen. Thank God that He did that. I don't know how far and deep or wide the burden of the Lord had for us. I can't imagine that. And the Bible says that when Jesus died on the cross, the sins of the whole world was poured on Him. My sins and your sins. And that's something that's spiritual that we can't understand, but we accept it by faith because the Bible says so. Amen. Someday Jesus will come. I hope that you catch that burden. Amen.
Yes.
God is a God of power. He knows everything. He sees everything. Amen. He's omnipotent. You remember in the book of Genesis, God spoke, "Let there be light," and there was light. And that wasn't the sunlight, as you know, the sun out there.
Yeah,
amen. That was the light that come from God.
Yeah.
And that's amazing. And pretty soon He created the heaven and the earth. And now here we are.
Wow.
Amen. This earth has its orbit around the sun. Wow. We get too far, we'll freeze to death. We get too close, we'll burn up.
Amen.
You know who's in charge of that? God is.
Amen.
Amen. I remember as a little boy in Cayenne, Alaska. That's a village near Kotzebue. I was laying on my back in the winter looking at all the stars. And then just as a little boy, I realized, boy, it goes on and on and on and on and on and on. There is no end. Amen?
Right.
There is no end. And that was just way too much for my little mind to handle.
Amen.
I'm glad that God saved me.
Amen.
Amen. Help me realize who we are and where we came from. Amen. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He created the angels. And of course, you understand the story of how the third of the angels fell from heaven. Lucifer deceived the third of the angels in heaven. And so there was the beginning of sin. There was the beginning of hatred. There is the beginning of murder. And there was the beginning of darkness. And then when God created man, man sinned. Man turned his back on God. And now here we are. We live in this old sinful world. Death, murder, war, hatred, just trouble all over the place, ruined lives. And that's been going on throughout history. Amen. Way back in the olden days, there were people who were unhappy because they didn't have Jesus Christ. They were unhappy. They were empty because they didn't know Jesus Christ. Throughout history, even before technology, back then they didn't have cell phones. They had wagons. They had horses. Amen? Many of them lived on a farm, so on and so forth. And the kids, how'd they keep themselves busy anyway? Without a cell phone throughout all these years, throughout history, how'd they keep themselves busy? And of course, you know, you realize there are a lot of people who grew up to be good people. There are a lot of people who grew up to be intelligent and smart and influential and powerful throughout history. Amen. But now here we are in 2017. Man, it's like the whole world exploded with technology in the last 100 years. Amen. It's really amazing. My wife, she told a story about her and her niece when they were little girls. And they were just playing around. She said, wouldn't it be neat if we could carry our phones around? And this was long before cell phones came around. And now here we are. Amen. Time flies. God knows what's going on. God knows who you are. God is a God of power. Yeah. Amen. God brought Israel out of Egypt. He parted the Red Sea. He protected them in the wilderness, provided for them. The Bible says their shoes didn't even get old. God can do that. Amen. He's a God of power. God's a God of knowledge. Some of you remember Solomon. God gave him wisdom. Amen. And we can have that wisdom as well just by reading the book of Proverbs. Just learning and growing in the Lord. The Bible says we have Christ in us, the hope of glory. Amen. Who is the author of wisdom? Who's the giver of life? God's a God of knowledge. He knows what's going on. He tells us about the future. Thank God we know about the future. Amen. Thank God we know what's going on. Thank God we're not left. How's that say? Thank God that we're not left without knowledge. Thank God we know where we're going. Amen. Amen. I remember going to Bible Institute in Barrow, Alaska, Pastor Nick Serino teaching, and we were studying Genesis chapter 1, and I found out that, hey, our universe is surrounded by ice, and heaven is northward. Amen. And, you know, I got excited about that. Amen. It's you know what it's like? It's like, you know, I remember we came here when was probably about 10 years ago. Not here, but we went to Chicago. And we had to rent a little box for the GPS. And I think a few people might have had a GPS on their phone, but we didn't have one. And then I think that a little box was kind of like, you know, out of date or something. We wanted to go to the nearest Walmarts. And we traveled about 80 miles to get to a Walmart. And before we got to that destination, according to what that little box said, we saw a sign, Walmart. Hey, that's closer. But we traveled about 80 miles. And then this was before the cell phones came. You know what happened? We had to get on a ferry and to get across to go towards that Walmart. You know what I did? You know, for being first time in the city, there were two lanes that got on the ferry and two lanes that got out. And true story, there was, when we drove up, there were two lanes full of cars. There were about maybe 10, 15 cars, maybe 12, 20, something like that. And then I realized, hey, that lane on the left is empty. I think I'll go on that lane and wait right there. And we waited about 5-10 minutes, I guess, for the ferry to start allowing people to go in. And then when they said go, I said, I'm going to speed up real quick and get in front of everybody. And so that's what I did. And so we got in the ferry. And then on our way back, we wanted to get back on the ferry, but this time they were going to charge us. And I said, how come they didn't charge us the first time? And you know what it was? I was on a lane that was the exit lane. Somehow I got away with it. I don't know. I don't think she charged us on the way in, but she charged us on the way back. She said I might get a bill in the mail, but we didn't get one. So that was kind of interesting. But nowadays, we have cell phones that are up to date, and boy, oh boy, technology is going over the roof, amen. You know what, I kind of wonder if we'll have technology in the millennium? That's kind of interesting. God knows everything. He prophesied the coming Messiah. Let's go to Genesis 3:15. Many of you know that passage right there. Way back in the book of Genesis, God tells us that there's a Savior coming. Amen. Someday we'll see him face to face. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. You know who that's talking about? That's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Yes. And that's talking about the devil. And someday God will destroy the devil and put him in the lake of fire. Amen. And I hope that you're saved. I hope that you'll go to heaven someday. Amen. God prophesied about the nation of Israel. Someday they'll rule the world. Isaiah chapter 9. You know, a lot of people don't like that, but that's what the Bible says. Isaiah chapter 9. I learned also as a younger Christian that Israel is always focuses, excuse me, the world always focuses on Israel.
That's right.
Almost every day you see on the news something about Israel. They were the focus in the Old Testament, amen?
Yeah.
And they're still the focus today. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
Yes.
Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. And you know what? That's going to happen. That's going to take place. That's going to be fulfilled. And nobody can stop it.
No, sir.
People in the world will try to stop it, but they can't do it. It's not going to happen.
That's right.
Thank God Bible prophecy is true. Amen.
Woo!
Thank God that we have the answer. Oh boy, if you got a King James Bible, you know what? You've got the answer. You ought to be happy for that.
Amen.
You ought to be glad for that. I remember seeing a clip, and I don't know if you've seen it before, on YouTube about Chinese receiving a Bible for the first time. And they didn't know that they were going to get Bibles. There were a bunch of Christians in a room, probably about 20 of them. And they started to open the suitcase. And when the lady opened the suitcase, she grabbed a Bible and she said, these are Bibles. And all of a sudden, they all rushed towards that suitcase. And many of them, they were all wrapped in plastic. Without even opening the plastic, they just started to smell it, embrace it. And they started to cry and weep over the Word of God. You know what? That's what we ought to do with our Bible. It's precious. Oh, it might be used. It might be marked up. But you know what? It's precious.
Yes, sir, it is.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
It's God's Word.
Amen.
Thank God we have the Word of God. Amen.
Yes, sir,
if you
sir.
Could fall in love with the Word of God. And I thought to myself, oh, boy. Lord, please don't send them Bible correctors over there.
Amen.
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 Because them Bible correctors, oh boy, they'll tell them, oh, it's got mistakes. You can't trust it. It's unreliable, so on and so forth. Leave them alone. Let them love that Bible. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I thank God for His Word and Bible truth. Amen.
Amen.
The Bible tells us about the millennium and the end of the world. You can't go to it now, but if you go to Matthew 24, Jesus tells us what's going to happen. Thank God we know what's going to happen in the future.
That's right.
Amen. We know the Antichrist is coming. We know the great tribulation is coming.
Yeah.
Amen. God knows everything.
Right.
God sees everything.
Yep.
And God sees everyone.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Amen. He knows what's going on in your life.
Right.
He knows what you're doing behind the scenes. He knows the secret things of your life.
Right.
He knows everything. The Bible says everything will come into judgment.
That's, right.
That's what the Bible says.
Amen.
Amen. But Jesus, He came to save us. He came to die for us on the cross. Amen. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16, verse 21. Jesus said, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto His disciples how that He must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53, beginning at verse 1. Who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He wasn't a handsome fella. You know, you see all these pictures of Jesus, and most of them were handsome. Jesus wasn't handsome. He could have made himself handsome.
Yeah,
amen. But he chose not to.
Right.
That wasn't his purpose.
Yeah. Right.
Amen. You know what? They saw more of his character than how he looked. And you know, that's the way it is with us. If you have a good character, that's what people will see more than how you look. Amen. Amen. Verse 2, verse 3, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken, and he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was there any deceit in his mouth. Thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank God that he died for you and I on Calvary. Amen. God's everywhere. Psalms 139 says, though I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. Amen. God is everywhere. He's all powerful. He knows everything. Let's go to Psalms 94. Psalms 94. Almost done. verse 11. The Lord knoweth the thoughts of man, that they are vain.
Yes, sir.
That's what the Bible says, Isaiah chapter 66. Isaiah chapter 66, beginning at verse 15. For behold, the Lord will come with fire, and with his chariots like a whirlwind,
yes,
to render his anger with fury, and his rebuke with flames of fire. For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many. They that sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind one tree, in the midst eating swine's flesh, and the abomination and the mouse shall be consumed together, saith the Lord. Boy, God's word is amazing. Amen. For I know their works and their thoughts. It shall come that I will gather all nations and tongues, and they shall come and see my glory.
Yeah.
It won't be too long. Jesus is coming. Amen.
Amen.
You got to repent. You got to get ready. Someday you will meet your God. The Bible says, prepare to meet thy God. Amen. Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. Two more verses. Luke chapter 8, verse 17. Thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ.
That's right,
amen. He's so good. He's so kind.
Thank you, Lord.
You know what? If he wasn't good, if he wasn't kind, I wouldn't follow him.
That's right, amen.
But he's been good and kind to me. And you know what? If you get saved, he'll be good and kind to you.
Amen.
Amen. Luke chapter 8, verse 17. For nothing is secret that shall not be made manifest. Neither anything hid that shall not be known and come abroad. Amen. John chapter 1. God sees you where you are. He knows where you are right now. John chapter 1 verse 50. Jesus answered and said unto him, because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than these. Amen. God, the Lord Jesus Christ knew where Nathanael was. The Lord Jesus Christ knows where you are.
Yes, sir.
And you know what? He loves you. He cares for you. He wants to save you.
Amen.
Amen. Would you receive him? Would you trust the Lord Jesus as your Savior?
Yes. Come on.
He knows everything that's going on. The Bible says that you can't save yourself. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Not of works, as any man should boast. There is none righteous, no, not one. We need the Lord Jesus Christ. You and I need the Lord Jesus Christ. You cannot save yourself. Are you saved? Are you sure you're saved?
Amen.
If you died today, would you go to heaven? That's a good question. Amen. If you died today, would you go to heaven? That's a good question. You ought to ask yourself that. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor, come on in.
Hello, this is Pastor Gene Kim of San Jose Bio Baptist Church. Have you ever asked this question, that if you were to die today, are you 100% sure that you can go to heaven? My friend, it's so simple to get saved. You first got to realize that you can't go to heaven because you've sinned against God. And God, as a holy judge, he has to judge sin with a burning hell. So it is very important that you feel sorry over your sinful condition. And if you do, there is hope for you. You see, Jesus, who is God, left heaven, came down here on earth, died on the cross, raised himself from the dead. Why did he do all that? So his blood can wash away the sins for you. So you see, that's your only way to heaven, of what he did on the cross, and not what you do in cleaning up all your sins, and going to church, getting baptized, or doing any sort of good work. It's faith alone in what Jesus did on the cross. If you can do that, then all you have to do is say that to God. You might say, well, I don't know how to say it. Can you help me out? Sure. You can say it this way. Dear God, I am sorry for being a sinner. I believe Jesus is God who died and resurrected so his blood can wash away my sins. I trust in that alone and not my good works. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Congratulations, my friend. If someone were to ask you, how did you get saved? It's very simple, right? What did you do? I just put my faith on what Jesus did on the cross. That's it. My friend, congratulations on your salvation. Right now, because Satan can't damn you to hell, what he's going to try to do now is try to ruin your life. And he did a very good job in this world. That's why it's so hard to find truth, and there are so many lies with a gazillion different churches, different Bibles, different beliefs, different religions. So my friend, it is so important to grow in truth and get involved in a Bible-believing work that can save you from a lot of trouble. There are four things we recommend for you to do, which is found in the resources link below. Number one, get involved in a Bible-believing church near you. Number two, study the King James Bible issue and have only that kind of Bible, no other modern version Bible. Number three, study dispensationalism so you can find the right doctrine and truth. Number four, study only under Bible-believing teachers. My friend, this is all explained further in the resources link below, so please click on it and get to work in a Bible-believing work, because you only have one life to live for Him, and you don't want to waste it away by the devil.
And I'll be inside that great palace, and the smoke will be so thick, I'll drop to my knees, and I'll drop to my face like those Navy SEALs do, and I'll start crawling. I start calling, and I'll look down that ivory aisle there, and I'll see a throne, and I'll see some feet that got holes in them, and they got jewel sandals on. Then I'll pull myself up to those feet, and I'll cry on those feet, like that woman that cried on his feet, wiped the tears with her hair.
Hey, glory to God, you're going to let him do the shouting. You're going to say, oh, God, thank you. Hallelujah. And the angels will worship, and the cherubim will worship, and the seraphim will worship, and thank God an independent Baptist will worship.
Just the fact, folks, just the fact that we're in Christ will never see hell is enough to shout about it.
Another song said, once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. They searched through heaven and found a Savior. Amen. To save a poor lost soul like me.
Woo!
Glory to God.
He stood out there beside him and he'd go, ho, 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 Jesus saves. The Bible saves for God's sake. And he preaching, and the people that's ringing the bell, they'd be and he'd stand up, and people walk up and they said, wow, Santa Claus preaching. What?
Then you enter the throne of glory. Yeah.
Oh!
The Father opens up his arms. Come on, there's a banner raised up in the skies with all the angels.
You go to church.
He did not do anything for you. It's not through Buddha. It's not through the commandments. It's only through faith in the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Oh, I'm just going to stay still and I'll just study at home. I watch preaching on the TV.
No.
You can turn the preacher off. You ain't going to turn me off.
Like his skin turning to gold or something. You don't know what's going on. He's about two more steps. Here's that crowd. Hi, how you doing? Hey, Mom. Hi, Dad. Hey, Steve. Hey, Steve, like that. Way down there at the edge of that street, there's the Lord up there in glory. And down he comes off that throne. He always would come down for a sinner. And he comes down there. Well done, thou good and faithful servant of the joy of our Lord. That old boy's heart going down there, it says, forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever.
Then he laid down on that table, and Dr. Grace got out the scalpel, and he removed that old cold stony heart out of my friend. Oh, he threw it in the trash can, and he put a brand new heart into my friend's chest. And when he woke up, he looked around and he said, oh my, everything has been changed. Everything looks different. Oh, I'm so happy now that I had the heart operation.
Hey, praise God, for there's no other Savior like our God.
Oh, better God.